Animations are a great way to make your brand stand out. They can seem a bit scary and difficult for beginners, but they are actually quite easy to understand if you know the right CSS properties to use. And that's exactly what this video is about. This is Coding to Go. And in this video, you're going to learn every CSS animation property you need to create amazing animations and even make them interactive for the user. The animation property applies an animation between at least two styles. It is a shorthand for all of these properties that you see here. The first thing to ask yourself is, do I even need the animation property to achieve my goal? Sometimes when you only need to animate the change from one state to another, like changing on hover, then a simple transition will suffice. It doesn't matter how many properties you need to change if that change involves only one step. First this, then that. Then you use the transition property. But if your change contains more than one step, but rather a sequence of multiple steps, then you need an animation. Also, when you have an ongoing occurring change, something that is constantly being animated in the background, then you would also use an animation. Before you can assign an animation to an element, you first need to create it using the add keyframes rule. Then you give your animation a name, like spin for example. It's completely up to you how you call it. Inside this keyframes rule, we need to define our animation sequence. Each step during the animation is a certain percentage value. 0% is the beginning of the animation, and 100% the end. Every value in between is going to be some time during the animation. We want to spin this element and turn it into a circle. So at 100%, meaning at the end, the element should be rotated and round. So we use transform rotate to rotate the element by 360 degrees. We also change the border radius to 50% to turn it into a perfect circle. Now we need to assign this keyframes animation to our element using the animation name property. Animation name, spin. And we also need to define how long our animation should be using animation duration. Let's say it's 3 seconds long. Now, when we save and refresh, our animation will play one time and then jump right back into its initial state. Let's make it more complex. Let's say that at 50%, meaning in the middle of the animation, we want to increase the size of the element using scale 2. This will make the element grow and rotate simultaneously. Also, it doesn't keep the scale of 2. It shrinks back to its initial size. To maintain the size until the very end, we need to add scale 2 to the end of the animation as well. So when you are changing properties during the animation, you need to apply that state during every step in the animation to keep the change until the end. If you don't do that, then the keyframes will only apply for that one step in the sequence. I also want to wait with the rotating. First, the element should grow and then rotate. Currently, it happens at the same time. For that, at 50% of the animation, I need to use transform rotate 0. Also, border radius 0. Now it grows first and then it spins. So I hope you understand that you need to be very specific of when to animate what CSS property. If it's not specified, it will just assume the rest of the sequence and blend perfectly from one step to the next. By now we know how to define the animation sequence using keyframes and the duration. You can use every CSS property to basically create any type of animation. You just need to be creative enough. But that's not all. Let's look at a few properties to fine-tune our animation. The first one was animation duration. This defines how long the animation should take. So if I set this to 0.5 seconds, then it will play very fast. 3 seconds is a bit slower. The next property is the animation timing function. Its initial value is ease. This will make it slow down at every animation step to make it smoother. We could also set this to linear to make it play at a consistent speed. There's also ease in, ease out, and ease in out. If you are into video editing, you probably already know the exact difference this makes. Simply explained, it determines the speed curve of the animation, when it should run faster and when slower. Using linear will make it play with a consistent speed, and using any kind of easing will make the animation smoother by slowing down on every step in the animation sequence. The next property is the animation delay. Here you can define how long the animation should wait before playing. If I set this to 1 second, then it will simply wait 1 second before starting. Very simple. The animation iteration count controls how many times the animation should play. Its default value is 1, which is why we need to refresh the page every time, because it only plays one time. But you can specify any number, for example 3, to make it play 3 times. You can also set this to infinite. This is very interesting, because then the animation will never stop playing. This is pretty cool for looping animations. Let's continue with the animation direction property. Normally, the animation plays from start to end, but if you set this to reverse, it will play backwards from end to start. So it starts at the last frame, which is a circle, and turns backwards into a square. Very simple. If you have multiple iterations, then you can set this to alternate, which will make it alternate between forwards and reverse. So it will play forwards, and then backwards, and then forwards, backwards, and so on. When talking about the animation fill mode property, we should have an iteration count of 1, and a normal animation direction. Then, when the browser refreshes, our animation will play one time and then jump right back into its initial state. These are the default values. I want the element to stop at the last frame, so that it stays a circle. For that, I can use the animation fill mode and set this to forwards. This will stop the animation on the last frame once it's finished. This way, the animation has a lasting effect on the element. If you don't use animation fill mode forwards, then the element will play its animation and then jump right back into its initial state like nothing ever happened. Now let's talk about the most interesting CSS animation property yet, the animation play state. This property allows the user to interact with the animation. You can make it play and stop on certain events. Let's say we have an infinitely playing animation, and the animation play state is running. Then we see our animation looping in the browser. But now we can also add a hover effect to the element, and set the animation play state here to paused. The animation will stop playing once we hover over it. Only when the mouse is not on the element, the animation will play. Of course, you can also make it the other way around, and only make it play on hover. Now the animation play state property becomes even more interesting when combined with JavaScript. Then you could add buttons to change the value of this property on click. All you need is a click event listener that changes the element.style.animationPlayState to either running or paused. And there you go. The user can easily pause and continue the animation with just a few lines of code. And by the way, all of these properties that we used so far can be combined in only one line of code by just using the animation shorthand. Just remember the correct order of the values. Now, all of this theory would have been for nothing if we don't put this into practice, which is why I have prepared a little coding exercise for you. We want to create this loading animation you see here. We are rotating the element using transform rotate x, rotate y, and rotate z to rotate the element on all three axes. If you want, you can pause the video and code it yourself, or just watch how I do it. Alright, let's start. We need a simple div that we call loading. We turn this into a square with a border and a slight border radius. Using box shadows, I can make the glow effect work. Now we are using absolute positioning to put the element in the center of the screen. We also make sure it is above everything else using Z index of 10. Now we apply our animation, which is about 2 seconds long. It is called loading. The timing function is easeInOut to make it smooth. And it is played an infinite amount of times. Now to the interesting part. Our keyframes animation is using transform rotate for the X, Y, and Z axis of the element. First, everything is on 0. At 33% of the animation, we rotate the element on the X axis by 180 degrees. At 67%, we keep that change and rotate the element on the Y axis as well. Then, at 100%, we still keep both changes and rotate the element on the last axis as well. And since a 180 degree rotation looks exactly like no rotation at all, we cannot see the animation resetting from 100 to 0, which is great. This was coding to go. I really hope you learned something new today. And if you want to learn more about web development, watch this video right here.